think. Okay. So, so as I say, so any function of then of a superfield, if we can expand it in a Taylor expansion or so, it will be also a superfield, and then we have rules of building up operators or in Lagrangians so that there will be they will describe interactions. So that's that. This is a straightforward proof, but it's very important. So please keep that in mind. Okay. Yes. Yes.
And in this case, we define it as
the same thing, exactly the same thing.
But it's not a rotation, it's a kind
of. Yes, on the rotation is invariant. That's why it's the scalar. On the rotation is invariant.
No, but usually a more general rotation would be a rotation which mixes up that coordinates for space and superspace, or for the usual part of space.
Oh, well, you want to define in that regard, yes. But this is a scalar. In the old way that we define scalars. In particular, as I told you the previous time, the first component of S will be a scalar field. And every single term in the standard definition of what a scalar is, and every single term will have epsilon times psi, and that will be a scalar also. That will be all of them will be Lorentz scalars. So in that sense, we are defining scalars to be Lorentz scalars. That's Yes, yes, that's a good point. Yes, very good. Very good. So that's the first property. Also, linear combinations of superfields are superfields, and for this we don't need a proof because it's essentially straightforward because we use the linearity of the differential operator, so it's straightforward, but it's good to know. Then starts the less trivial things is that the derivative with respect to time with a space-time coordinates of a superfield that is also a superfield. Of course, if S is itself a superfield. And that again is straightforward to prove because you can see from the definition there that you put the derivative of S, you can take it out and then it comes out as a factor also on the right hand side. Exactly. Yes, this is an example of a superfield which is not a scalar, for instance, because it will be a vector, we will have a vector like a behavior as under Lorentz transformations. But, and this is the important part, but the derivative with respect to the coordinates theta of a superfield is not a superfield. Okay, this is important. And I will try to argue. Since we try to have the delta of d alpha s. We will describe that as I d alpha s epsilon q plus epsilon bar q bar. And this is equal to I d alpha of the whole thing because there is no theta dependence into this part, okay? So you can take out the derivative of the whole commutator. And then that will be equal to I d alpha of, since S is a superfield, now we can use the definition over there. So this will be epsilon, the parade, I'm sorry, now I know why. Epsilon q plus epsilon bar q bar acting on S. Yes?
We expect the differential operator out of the commutator because the q's they have interdependence.
No. Very good question. Very good question. Q here is the abstract object, is the abstract operator.
But how can we lose that dependence by abstraction?
How can we lose that dependence? Huh? No, there is no dependence. I mean, Q has no, is an operator, doesn't depend on X, doesn't depend on theta. It's just, it's an abstract object that is a that defines what the supersymmetry transformation is, the algebra is. The representation of Q is this Q's, and this is depends on theta, and this is the argument, this is the basis of the argument precisely, because now they depend on theta, and then this is different from okay. It is different from that because we know that that d alpha doesn't commute. With the differential operator, because these differential operators have derivatives of thetas and have and thetas themselves, so this commutator is not zero. Okay, that's the thing. So this is the argument. Precisely, this is the argument to tell you that this object, d alpha s, is not a superfield. Okay, and the reason is that the operator itself does not commute with the supersymmetry transformation. Yes. Sorry,
the transformation law you made use of in the inequality.
In the inequality?
Yeah, basically the last one. Yeah.
This one?
Yeah, the transformation law that gave the object on the right, the term on the right of that, wasn't that derived for scalar fields?
Yes.
And who says that the derivative with respect to the theta points has to be a scalar field? Why does it transform in a different way that might be actually equal to points on the right?
I don't know if I get your point, but the thing that where I derived in the past was this equation. This. I derived this for you in the previous lecture.
How do we know that equation is equal to some valid for the derivative with respect to alpha?
Exactly. That's precisely what we're showing is not valid. So we're saying that
assuming now that this is valid for the derivative with respect to alpha.
No. I'm just trying to define the transformation for d alpha in this way, yes. And then I proved that it's different from that. So that means that the d alpha does not transform as a superfield, because this is the. Oh,
or a spinner or a
sorry. Yes, absolutely. No, it holds. Yes, sorry. Yes, absolutely. You're right. Yes, this is a general definition for that. Every superfield will transform in this way.
Right.
Yes, that's essentially how it transforms. Yes. Sorry, I didn't understand your point. Thank you for the explanation. Yes. Yes. So, and a valid point. Yes. So then. What is it that we have seen this situation in the past? We have seen that the derivative doesn't transform in the right way, so we have to do something to make it transform in the right way. So, have you seen that something similar in your past? Sorry? Yes, trying to do something else to make it so like a covariant derivative. So that's precisely what we are going to do now. Very good. Sorry, another way to see that this will not be a superfield, if this argument is not fully convincing for you, is that if we take the derivative of a superfield, we take out the last component of thetas, the last component of the superfilling, the expansion of theta, they have two thetas and two theta bars. Remember that when we made the expansion, the last term we could have was had the biggest number of thetas, it was two thetas and two theta bars, and after that it was zero. So when you take derivatives, you kill one of the thetas, and you will have only two thetas and one theta bars, or two theta bars and one theta. And under supersymmetry, this will be generated. Okay, so under supersymmetry, this will be generated. And then you will see that truncating that part will not be a consistent thing. It's like having a vector, like having a field, which is a vector, a mu, and then you say that the first component of that vector, is that a field? Then we'll say it's not a field because it doesn't transform properly under space time transformations, because you have the first component being non-zero and all the other components will be zero. When you make the transformation, you generate the other components by Lorentz transformations or so. So just setting all the components to zero except for one will not be a valid field. So in that spirit, this is not a super field in the same way. Okay. Okay. So, but if we define now what we call covariant derivatives, and the covariant derivatives covariant derivatives d alpha, it will be d alpha plus I sigma mu alpha beta dot theta bar beta dot d mu, and then d bar alpha dot is minus d bar alpha dot plus I theta sigma mu theta beta beta alpha dot d mu. This derivatives just build out of the derivative with respect to alpha plus extra terms, similar to the term that appears in the definition of the Qs, by the way. They satisfy the following algebra, in the sense that they commute with all the Qs. D alpha Q beta equals D alpha Q bar beta. And then we have D alpha dot Q beta and D alpha dot Q beta dot equal to zero. So they anti-commute with the Qs. And since they anti-commute with the Qs, they will commute with the epsilon Qs. And then that means that in particular, they will satisfy that this d alphas will commute with the epsilon Qs, and then you will have a superfield. And then d alpha s is a superfield. D alpha s is a superfield. Also, you can find the commutators of the anti-commutators of the d alphas. And they happen to be 2i, let me just get it right, sigma mu d mu. Okay, so it's a very similar properties than the Qs, but they are special in the way that, in the sense that d alpha s is a superfield, because now there's the argument that proved that the partial derivative with respect to alpha was not a superfield, when you apply to this covariant derivative, you go through the commutator and get it to transform it in the same way, because now the d alpha will commute with the epsilon q, so you can move it out of this factor. Okay, so that's an important result, and we will be dealing with this d alphas.
Excuse me, how did this commutators to commutators?
Excuse me? Yes, because remember that the epsilons are anti-commuting numbers. And so then, as we described in the past, so then we move, once you have this object, will be just a commuting object. Yeah. Good points, yeah. Good. Okay, so continue with the remarks. We try to say S to be just scalar field is a superfield. Only if F is a constant. If F is a constant, so you can use the same kind of argument. Only if it is a constant, you can take it out of the differential operator. So that means that a constant is just a superfield. So this is a trivial superfield, but it's a superfield. However, but for instance, S to be equal to say a constant times theta is not. Superfield. And the argument is the same. You plug it into here, then theta will be act on by the differential operator, so it doesn't commute with the q operators, so then it will not be a superfield. Another way to see it is that you assume that this is a superfield. You look at the transformations that I gave you, that I filled up that blackboard in the previous lecture. You can see this constant will be like one of the psi spinner, and you will see how it transforms, and it will generate, for instance, a term without theta, for instance, because the delta phi, remember, was proportional to psi, epsilon psi. So it will generate something, and then this by itself will not be a superfield, but because you have to complete it with all the other components. Similar to the example I gave you about the first component of a vector not being a proper vector field, not being a proper field. Okay, so.
Excuse me?
Yes?
What if C is a constant spinner?
A constant spinner, yes. Or C and any spinner. Constant or non constant?
One moment. If that's C on the blackboard, that is a constant
spinner. C. No, it could be anything. You want me to call it psi? I can do it.
I thought it was a C number.
Oh, no, yes, probably I was confused. Let me call it psi, yes. Yeah, it's very good. Thank you. Yes, that's proper, more proper. So it's not a superfield. And the argument, as I told you, is the same. And so for instance, note that delta phi will be proportional to epsilon psi. Epsilon psi. Eh? So then it will generate a term without thetas. Okay. The same thing here. Because remember that here you have that delta psi will have a term which is epsilon d mu phi. So if phi is not a constant, it will generate a psi component. Okay, that's an easy way to see that. You know, you have S to be F, which we can just set it to be phi. So if S is phi, then you will see that it will generate a term proportional to theta, which is called delta psi, that will be proportional to d mu phi, as you can see in the general transformation of the superfield before. So that means that if you start with no term proportional to theta, so you start with no psi, you will generate it by having a d mu phi there. But if phi is a constant, this term is zero, and then we are okay. Okay? Is that clear? So we have the general way to see how an object is a superfield is to follow this argument of the transformation rules. But there is an easy way to see it explicitly, just looking by components, how one component itself cannot be a superfield by itself. Because by transformation, you generate the other components. That you can see in these two cases, that's an easy way to see it. Is that clear? The two psi's here are the same. Here. This psi and this psi, yes. So, and they're the same is important. So the reason is that if I have the superfield to be just psi times theta, and here that means that I'm setting phi to be zero. But when I make it phi, the scalar thing is zero, because it's only psi. But by a supersymmetric transformation, I can generate the phi, because I know that delta phi will be epsilon psi. If I have a psi different from zero, I will generate a phi. The same thing, you have a vector where all the components except for one are zero. You generate them, all the other components, by Lorentz transformations. So the same thing, you're generating here all the other components by supersymmetric transformations. Okay. Okay. But that doesn't mean that truncating a superfield will never be a superfield. So there are ways to truncate the superfield that are still a superfield. A particular case is just setting this phi to be constant, but that's trivial. But there are other non-trivial ways. And in general, we have to do it because the general superfield S that I wrote for you is not an irreducible representation of supersymmetry. The general superfield has many components, many scalars, fermions, and even a vector. And you can truncate some of them to be zero, and it is still a superfield. So we have to find consistent ways of eliminating some of these components. So S is a reducible representation of supersymmetry. And so we can eliminate some of the components and still keep it to be a superfield. Okay, and the consistent way of doing this is by imposing constraints, rather than just take this general superfield and start killing things or setting some relations among them. You can impose well-defined constraints that guarantee that what you are left up is a superfield. So in general, And this will define several superfields that I will now describe. For instance, one constraint is what it will define a chiral superfield. A chiral superfield we define by since it will be a special case of S, I will not call it S, I will call it phi. And it will be defined such that if we act on it by the supercovariant derivative D and set it to be equal to zero. Okay, so we impose this constraint, D bar phi equal to zero. That will be that will kill some of the components of the superfield, of the general superfield, and it will still be a superfield, because remember that D acting on something, D acting on a field is still a superfield. So this is a well-defined constraint, and so this will be what defines a chiral superfield. There is also the anti-chiral superfield, this one will be, yes, yes. And you will see why in the next few minutes or in the next lecture. So we call it phi bar, such that in this case, it's just d alpha phi bar equal to zero. There is also what is called a vector superfield. For that, we just choose v equals to v dagger. And another one that is probably less popular, but it has appeared, for instance, in string theory. It's a linear superfield. And it's called L for linear. And the linear superfield is annihilated by two of the supersymmetries, by two of the covariant derivatives. And it's also real. So we will spend some time describing each of the, this is essentially the anti-chiral version of that. So we will spend some time describing the chiral superfield and the vector superfield. Why? Because the chiral superfield will be the objects that will have the quarks and leptons included. The vector superfield will be the object that will have the gauge fields included, gauge and gauginus, and so on. And the linear superfield will have antisymmetric tensors that at the end can be proved to be equivalent to a chiral superfield, so it's usually not very much in use because you can reduce it to a chiral superfield, although sometimes it's convenient to keep the formalism for linear superfields. So we'll spend some time describing each of them. So let me start with the chiral superfield. And actually, now this is section 3.2. So as I told you, we have this constraint, d bar on phi equal to zero. And to find the components of phi, we will make a trick, and the trick is we will define a new coordinate, which I will call y, y mu, to be the standard spacetime coordinate plus I theta sigma mu theta bar. Okay, so this is just a trick to simplify some of the calculations. If you do this, then so then if we consider now phi as a function of y, theta, and theta bar, which is just because this is just a change of variable, so I can do, instead of x, I can just consider y now. then the constraint this d bar on alpha dot on phi has to be 0. But this one, by using the definition of d bar that I have over there, this is a minus d alpha bar on phi. minus, the other thing is that now phi depends on theta bar, not only by its dependence explicitly on theta bar, but also by this dependence here on theta bar. So it's minus, it's d phi by dy times dy by d theta bar alpha dot. Okay? And let me check back my definition. Sorry. I have a minus sign here in the definition of t. Yes. Sorry about that. Yes, it's a minus sign there. It's important here. And so that's minus I theta beta sigma mu beta alpha dot d mu phi. Okay. And so you can see now that this is equal to minus d bar alpha dot phi, and the derivative of phi with respect to y mu is a minus d mu phi dy mu by d theta bar. Dy mu by d theta bar, I have to take the derivative of this. So the derivative with respect to theta is 0, but it anticommutes with theta, so I pick up a minus sign, and then I have to take the derivative with respect to theta bar, which will give me 1, or delta alpha bar beta dot, alpha dot beta dot. So this will give me minus I theta sigma mu component alpha dot. Okay? I insist I pick up the minus sign by taking the derivative of theta bar, jumping the theta, I get the minus sign. And then I have minus I theta sigma mu component alpha dot times d mu phi. And the nice thing about this is that this term cancels with this term, because this is a plus and that's a minus. And this is equal to minus d bar alpha dot phi. But we know that by definition, the chiral superfield satisfies the constraint d bar phi equal to 0. So that means that this d bar phi is equal, now it's partial derivative with respect to theta bar of phi equal to 0. So that means that this field has a very simple expansion, because now it does not depend on theta bar. So this implies that the field phi is only a function of y and theta. here, not theta bar. Okay? So now, this simplifies our lives, because now we can make the expansion of phi in terms of components by expanding different powers of thetas. Since there's no theta bar, we stop at the only, at the quadratic component. So in components, phi now can be expanded as a standard scalar field, plus there is a root 2 here, which is just conventional. So I have y, it's a linear term in theta, plus the quadratic term in theta, which is theta theta, times a function of y. And I cannot continue because higher powers of theta will give me 0. Okay? This makes our life much more simpler compared to the, for instance, to the general superfield that I wrote the previous time. We have thetas and theta bars, so we have to combine different powers of thetas and theta bars, and that's why we ended up with so many terms. This one has only the linear, the independent piece, linear in theta, and quadratic in theta, and nothing else. And then these fields, each of them, this will be just a standard scalar field. And in for physics, this will describe what? It will describe the quarks, the leptons, and the Higgs, for instance. This will be a spin 1/2 object. So that will define, will describe the quarks, the leptons, and the Higgsino. Okay? And this object is new, and you will find, you will see how useful it is, and it's usually called an auxiliary field. We will see that it will be a field, it will not be a physical field, but at some point we can eliminate it by its equations of motions, but we will see that when we describe the Lagrangians. But at the moment you can see that the chiral superfield, you can, it is precisely, it has, phi is complex, it has another two components, so it's 4, and psi is complex, but it has an index alpha, so it has 2 times 2 equals 4 components. So there are 4 fermionic objects and 4 bosonic objects. Okay, so that's, F is needed in this regard. So. And okay, so this is the chiral superfield, and we will be using it a lot because, as I told you, it describes all the interesting physical particles that we are used to in the standard model. So that's now I have defined for you the superfield. I will do the same thing for the other superfields, for the vector and so on. And after that, then we move to the actions, describing the interactions among the superfields. Okay, so see you next time.